Should I get a hair transplant? I've been facing the issue of hair loss since 18 years old. I'm now 21 and was just wondering if I should get a hair transplant. I will provide the pictures of my hair loss progression over 1 year. I'm guessing I'm somewhere between Norwood 4 to 4.5.
Thank you for your question. You've asked if you should get a hair transplant and you've submitted some very good pictures from age 18 and now age 21 about your progress with your hair loss. So I'm going to talk to you first about a few basic considerations when someone comes to me in my practice about hair loss. First, understanding what is causing your hair loss. Well, it is called male pattern hair loss or male pattern baldness, MPB. And when people suffer from this, there is a strong genetic pattern that can be seen in variable instances in a family's history. So myths such as maternal uncle being responsible for hair loss pattern are just myths. It can happen in families, but the age of onset can be fairly consistent. So you're unfortunately suffering from a very aggressive form of hair loss. You know, there's a something called the rule of decades that's known in our industry, and that is when you're in your 20s, 20% of your contemporary males will have hair loss, and as you hit your 40s and 50s, it's more like 50% of your contemporaries. So what's the underlying cause? Well, it's a genetic kind of cause where something called DHT, dihydrotestosterone, starts attacking the hair follicles. Now, the dihydrotestosterone was always there, but there is something that changes in the hair follicles that results in a sudden weakness to the effect of dihydrotestosterone. And what dihydrotestosterone does, or DHT, is it literally chokes away the hair follicle until it gets smaller and smaller. We refer to that as miniaturization. So a significant progress in the field of hair loss occurred in about 1997 with the introduction of a drug called finasteride. Now, finasteride is an oral medication that blocks dihydrotestosterone, or DHT, and it reduces it considerably. And when people, most men statistically will respond to taking finasteride. Unfortunately, there has been a lot of concerns about long-term sexual side effects, and that is still being figured out. However, there is some real concerns such that a lot of people who come to me from all over the world are looking at finasteride on the internet and deciding they don't want to take it at all. They won't even try it, and they'd rather not do it. So then it gives us limited options in terms of medical choices. There's minoxidil, which has been around since probably the 80s, and it is a topical treatment. And unfortunately for a lot of men who start having this pattern of hair loss at a younger age, it tends not to be that effective. And so you are in a situation where you want to naturally have hair, and you're asking, should you have a transplant? Well, many years ago, it was standard in our industry to not treat people with transplantations who are very young because of a couple of reasons. One was the being realistic about what the appearance would be after the transplant. Unfortunately, when you have 80% of your contemporaries have full thick hair, even with the transplant, you can't get the same level of result. Second, it was the ongoing progression. You can transplant, you know, one hair, but if you're losing 2 to 3 hairs, then it's like you're taking one step forward and 2 steps back. So we always would say, you know, it's better if you do medical therapy and then come back to us when you're in a more mature state to be able to make a decision about what is more appropriate, age appropriate. You know, when you hit your 40s, 50s, and later, it's okay for a lot of men to have just a little bit of hair right in the middle, and it breaks up the bald scalp, and they look fine. But when you're in your, when you're young, that's not acceptable. Well, I'm going to tell you, educate you a little bit about something that I've been doing in the past couple of years, using a material called extracellular matrix. Now, in recent history, back in 2011, actually, there was a study published that demonstrated that men who have baldness or loss of hair have a certain stem cell that does not appear to continue to work. And it's a type of cell called a progenitor cell. And it's a very important part of the protection of the hair follicle. So you could think of dihydrotestosterone or DHT as an army storming the castle, and you can think of progenitor cells as a wall around the castle. So when the wall is breaking down, even with lower level of dihydrotestosterone, you can still lose hair because the same effect occurs. The hair gets choked, it miniaturizes and goes away. So a few years ago, the concept of using extracellular matrix was for hair loss was first introduced as a kind of a byproduct of using it for wound healing. And that's what the extracellular matrix is used for. It's really used for wound healing. So what I did over the past 2 years is I worked out and developed a combination of extracellular matrix with platelet-rich plasma and vitamin D that, when placed in a very specific way under the skin, at this in the level of the skin called the dermis, and to also do other treatments in combination in one time, I've been able to successfully reverse that thinning process of hairs that have gone from being thick oak trees to becoming thin saplings. Now, it doesn't mean I can bring back hairs that have been completely lost. I can't do that. Those are areas that have to be transplanted if we want to see hair grow in those areas. But the injection has been a huge game changer in helping people, particularly young people, in who are suffering from male pattern hair loss. So this is something that is what most people have not heard of. Patients come to my practice from all over the world, and at the same time, many people just in our local area in Manhattan and Long Island have never heard of this treatment. So this is something that I would consider. If you were to come into my office, this is one of the first things that I would recommend is treat the hair loss at the cellular level using something that activates your adult stem cells using this FDA-cleared device for wound healing referred to as extracellular matrix combined with platelet-rich plasma, which is drawn from your own blood and has some of the growth factors. If you've done any research, you've probably learned that people are using PRP or platelet-rich plasma for hair loss, but on its own, in my experience, PRP is not enough for hair loss. But in combination with extracellular matrix, I have been able to develop a very consistent result both for men and women in our practice. So that would be the first thing that I would say is, without even considering a hair transplant, let's save your hair and let's do that kind of treatment. Now, in deciding whether or not to do a hair transplant in my practice, I wait about a year after I do the injection. After that's done, we sit down and we discuss what you want and we make decisions about hair transplant based on a couple of factors. One is your donor hair density, how much hair you have in the back and how per square centimeter. The more hairs per square centimeter, the more we could transplant. It's like having more money in the bank. Looking at hair thickness and quality. It takes more fine hairs to cover areas that can be covered with one thick hair. And then, of course, looking at the area of coverage desired. You see, unfortunately, when people start first noticing hair loss, already they've lost 50% of their hair. So you can't restore everything from a limited area. So you have to spend the money in the bank, if you would, very carefully and strategically. A lot of actors and politicians understand this very well. They know that their face is on camera, so they build up their frontal hairline and add some volume in the center, and it looks very nice and natural. And when you think about it, life is right here in front of you, so you can consider doing things where instead of focusing on the back, you'd focus towards the front. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. Right now, I want to introduce you to this regenerative medicine and what we're calling hair regeneration, using extracellular matrix and platelet-rich plasma as a way to at least halt and reverse a lot of your thinning hair. In fact, many of our patients, they responded so well, it's as if we had done two hair transplants and we hadn't done a single surgical procedure. And what I also point out is the hair that comes back is so close together, because that's the way nature created it, that it's never possible to do the same job with a surgery. So interestingly, for a surgeon, I'm doing a lot of injections to help people with hair loss, considerably more than the surgical hair transplantation. So I know that we've introduced something new for you. I hope you learned something, and thank you for your question.